Jesus.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Glory to you, Lord God. Mm. You have been so faithful to us. From the rising of the sun to the setting of the same, your faithfulness is so great toward us.
Hallelujah.
In every season that we go through, it's your faithfulness that gets us through it to the next season. So we thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Father,
thank
for your presence.
Yes,
thank you, Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, you are so present in this place.
Thank you, Lord.
And just as we sang that it's your presence that's our weapon. Your word says that you go before us, you're our rear guard, and you station angels round about us. There's nothing, no weapon that can be formed against us that can prosper. And we bless your name, Father. Thank you, Lord God, that every word that you have spoken will come to pass in our lives.
Thank you, Lord.
And we glorify your name this morning.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Take a deep breath. Mm. My goodness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Jeanette.
Isn't it awesome just to be in the presence of the Lord and the presence of believers that we can glorify his name each and every week?
Absolutely.
So we want to welcome everybody. Do we have any first-time visitors? Anyone? No hands? Okay. Well, and we welcome our whole family.
Amen.
And we welcome Facebook Live as well. We're glad to have you all here. And if you're on Facebook and you're new to us, then please put it in the chat and we'll get in touch with you. Amen? So the word for you today, can you believe it's the end of the year? Goodness gracious.
I'm serious.
So we'll go into the new year with this, so make sure you get one. It's our gift to you. And any others that you want to give to maybe, you know, friends and family at Thanksgiving time, Christmas time, they're awesome. And there'll be $1 for each one. And then Thanksgiving, excuse me, and your Christmas card. So one side says Happy Hanukkah, and the other side says Christmas Eve. So that Sunday after Thanksgiving, we are going to have, it's the first night of Hanukkah, and we're going to have our very own Rob Campos.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. There you go. That's pretty awesome, getting applause before you even speak.
Amen.
so we are excited to hear what the Lord's going to bring, because he is a Messianic Jewish teacher, and I know he's filled up with the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Praise
our
God.
Christmas Eve service will be a holy night. We will have candlelight and worship to our Savior and a gift to all who attend. So our relentless Christmas carols, cookies and craft, first Friday, December 3rd, is a mouthful. And as we've said before, the time is filled, but we still do have a waiting list in the back. So just if you haven't signed up, then sign up, and you never know. You may be called. And this is a reminder. So you know how, you know, your entrance fee was a card to Dunkin' Donuts and Starbucks and Wawa, so $5 gift card, and also a dozen donuts. I keep saying a dozen donuts. Oh my gosh. Talk about being overrun. A dozen cookies. That will be your entrance fee and to our party that night. And we all did so well with our Thanksgiving dinner that we blessed the firemen with so many cards and just a beautiful blessing to them from all of us. But we want it to extend also to the church.
Right.
So it's not just the $5 cards for those that are coming to the Christmas dinner or Christmas time, but it's also to the whole family of Covenant Messiah Church. So bring them in, and you know, we'll be able to give them this time as a Christmas offering to our police department. Amen? Okay, so now, where's our list? You all got a list. Mm-hmm. Lots to do in this church. So this list is for Michelle Dunn, and she goes out to Mission Teens. And so she's requesting, I know they did this last year as well, she's requesting that we would look around our home Do we have gifts maybe that we just don't use, that you could re-gift? Do you have jewelry that's not, you know, broken or anything, like things that are nice? That they have a bazaar at Mission Teens, and these are the items on this paper that you could look for in your home. You know, to be able to bring them in to Michelle, and she'll bring them there, and they, you know, the people there at the rehab, they get a quarter, I think you said, right? If they don't have any money, so then they'll provide it. But they're all able, they're in rehab, and they're all able to purchase something for their family members. So you can look at your slightly loved fuzzy things, you know, like the little, you know, stuffed animals and, you know, your jewelry, like I said, tea towels. And then I thought to even add, because I was in the dollar store the other day, and I picked up some pot holders and towels that all matched. And you know how, like, you can look at a person going through rehab and be able to bless them so that they can bless their family.
Right.
So that's what this is all about. So everything that I just said for these things and for the gift cards for the police, they're all due on December 14th. Any questions? I hope not. We have a reminder that we will not be meeting for the next two Tuesday Bible studies. Amen? For 2 weeks. And our men's fellowship is at 8:30 on December 4th, that Saturday morning. And you can give Alan a call or text him at that number. Amen? I think, with all my notes, I think I've covered it all. And then our offering platform every week is text to give, covenantmessiah.com donate, and you can mail your offerings. But you can also put your offerings in the basket at the welcome table today. So let's pray. You know what? Let's stand and pray.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, Father God, we just continue to glorify your name. We continue to thank you for all of your faithfulness. You're so faithful to us that we can ask everyone here that they could bring in an offering, they can bring in a gift. Mm-hmm. And then we thank you because it's your faithfulness that causes it, Lord God.
That's right.
So we want to bless you and thank you for every person in here. Thank you, Lord God, for the faithfulness that they are to Covenant Messiah Church and the outreaches that we have, our tithes and offerings that go into the different things that we do. We just bless you and thank you for all of it, Lord God. You are the provider of all things, our Jehovah Jireh, and we glorify your name today. In Jesus' name, amen. And our children are dismissed, and you may greet.
Thank you.
All right. Well, it is good to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it?
Amen.
Isn't it so good? I love watching all of you gelling and uniting together. That is just so, so good. So happy Sunday to my favorite Sunday family. How are you all today? Come on in, Facebook. You have a place here with us. Let us know you're watching. Let us know where you're watching. Send us a like and a heart. And by all means, please share today's message. I think it's a good one straight from the Holy Ghost. So I want to just start out with something that I'm just so excited about to share with you. All of us need to be praying, right? We all need to be. We have these meetings. We have the men's prayer time. They pray at their men's fellowship that once a month, and we as women gather every Saturday on the phone at 8:30, and we pray for an hour. And we've been doing this for a very long time now, and God is just really honoring those times of prayer. And I just wanted to share Barb Rommelman, raise your hand, Barb, for those who don't know her maybe. Barb has continued to go to the Cherry Hill Women's Center, as you know, which is the abortion mill of southern New Jersey. And she has continued to go there every Saturday. And there's people that are just old-timers that have been going there for years. And, of course, she's gotten to know them well. Several weeks ago, this person showed up and looked like it was a person that was part of the team and was in agreement with them and praying these things down and ministering and whatnot, and she just started acting out. Barb was sharing this with us last week, yelling out at the people and shaming them and making the rest of the group look in a way that we don't want to look without the grace of God. You know, I think you're getting the point. So she shared that with us, and I said, well, Barb, we're going to really pray about this, because I remember that Acts 16 said that there was a slave girl that was following Paul around and was saying, follow them, you know, they're the teachers of God. But while she was doing that, it actually created division, and it created people not wanting any part of what the message of the gospel was, and such is the case here. And the Lord brought that to my remembrance right away. And so Saturday, while we were, as women, all on the phone line, Jeanette brought up this whole topic about abortion, and we just prayed so thoroughly in all different facets about it. Prayed for Barb, prayed for the team, and then we did what the scripture said Paul did in Acts 16. That she did, this woman was doing this. It said day after day, it went on and on, just as was the case with Barb and their team. And so we did what Paul did. We rebuked that spirit. We ask that if this girl is a plant that's really sent by the enemy to harm the message of love and acceptance and, you know, all that, that she would just go, or that she would be saved through it, that the very group she's in, she would be, you know, accepted and brought into salvation. So, Barb, tell us what happened.
The demon's gone.
Now, that's so good. Yeah. Do we have a handheld for her?
You're familiar with the security guard.
Hold on 1 second. So everybody can hear, including our Facebook family.
Okay. Anybody who's been there is familiar with the security guard.
Sure.
Anyway, at the end of the time last week, they got coffee. It was very cold for the escorts and for the security guard. And he went and took coffee to this one girl. She wasn't back this week, but Pastor Debbie said, we just need to rebuke her.
Yeah.
And it was just so great to see that she wasn't there this week.
Amen. And so, Barb, you're saying they brought her coffee as if she's part of
the
Cherry Hill Women's Center team.
Her last,
oh, that's amazing.
Her last word was, when the last pro-life person left, was to scream out, I love abortion.
Wow.
So, you know, we've seen people, and maybe one girl a week, one every 2 weeks, but it's worth it. And I would encourage anybody to go there. And there's just a blessing.
Yeah.
Sad as it is, there's a lot of people there that, you know, they have different views and everything,
sure,
but the bottom line is, we're not there for anybody else. We're there for the Lord.
That's right. That's right. And have been there myself since, you know, they're very careful in their approach. It's not condemnation. You don't win anybody over with any of that. And so anyway, if you're interested in going, you know, see Barb today, and I'm sure she would meet you there. And I also want to say some wording you use that they may not know. There's a security guard there who just videos us there, and like, he's going to put us on, what are you going to put us on, the, you know, against abortion times, or what, you know, how's that all going to work? So he really despises any pro-lifers that come there, and it's quite an experience to go. I would challenge you to make a trip there. You will see there are people driving by that'll just throw the finger at you and curse at the window. Oh, it's amazing. It's really amazing. The hate of the life message. It's just absolutely amazing. So anyway, we just let's just pray as a family for this person. Do you know her name, Barb? The woman? Yeah. Okay. Lord, we don't know her name, but we know that this woman's name is graven on your hands. That's what the Bible tells us. And so therefore, while she's a part of bloodshed, you shed blood for her, Lord. And so, Lord, she wasn't there this week. We don't know why that is. And we rejoice that there wasn't a disturbance in the midst of this gospel love outreach. But, Lord, if she does return, I just pray for wisdom for the team that's there. Show us how, if you were on that corner, Jesus, how would you handle this? And we just continue to rebuke Satan that's using her. And indeed, if she is part of that Cherry Hill team, Lord, I pray this is a great opportunity to win her over. You've placed her right in the midst of light. And I pray that just in a way that only you can, Holy Spirit, unleash and take the scales off her eyes, that she would see beyond what is being told to her, but she would see the truth in that midst. And we pray for this woman, and that she would not perish off this earth until she comes to you and receives saving knowledge. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, that we pray that. Amen? Amen. Amen. So, ladies, get on our prayer line on Saturdays. And here's the number. Marcia, you have that number? Jot it down. Take a picture of it with your phone. It's an hour, 8:30 to 9:30. And let me tell you, we go into hell with a water pistol, and we win every time. Amen. That's all I'm going to say on that. Anyway, so, okay, are we ready to do Luke? Oh, we're not on Luke. We haven't been on Luke. Whew. Ruth. Baby Ruth, right? Yes. Not only chapter 3, we're even going to get into chapter 4 a little.
Oh, my goodness.
Isn't that something, Nina? I'm telling you, he is faithful, isn't he?
Yes.
He really is. Somebody's been praying my messages speed up. So anyway, you got your prayer answered. Here's the number, as you can see. Can you see past me? And join us. You don't need to pray. You can just be in agreement. Because when any two or more agree on anything on earth and touch heaven, our Father in heaven does what we ask. Amen? Okay, last week, Ruth not only met Boaz, she had the audacity to propose to him. Can you believe it? That's exactly what happened. And she did it at the threshing floor, all the while following the directions of Naomi. And she was doing this and moved out in the confidence of it because she was following a very old Jewish law called the Levirate Law of Marriage. And we talked all about that last week. So if you weren't here, Facebook or those here or those who will be listening on CD, go back to last week's message and get the core of why that took place and why she was there. She asked Boaz to cover her. In other words, to be her kinsman redeemer. I love that while we're sitting here, our children are in that room next door, and Jean has come up with this amazing, what we do on Sundays with the children when we have children's church is we take the message from here in the sanctuary, and she implements it and, you know, dovetails it to their understanding. So there's forts being made back there in tents because she's teaching them what the covering of God is, as we learned last week. Isn't that awesome? So you should sign up to help out at children's church too, and you too can hide in a fort during church. Amen? See, it gets gooder and gooder. So anyway, she asked Boaz to cover her. In other words, she's asking Boaz to be her kinsman redeemer. That's what this is all about. And his response to this is, drum roll please, verses 10 through 12. Here we go. Then he said, blessed are you of the Lord, my daughter, for you have shown more kindness at the end than in the beginning, and that you did not go after young men, whether poor or rich. And now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you all that you request. For all the people of my town know that you are a virtuous woman. Now, it is true that I am a close relative. However, there is a relative that is even closer than I. There is a relative that is even closer than I. Uh-oh, time out. We have a problem. We were going along so good, and now we have this problem. Because Tom Cruise is going to first have to deal with Danny DeVito before this situation can come to pass. Amen? We do not know who this is. Maybe an older brother. But someone that is closer in relationship to Naomi than Boaz is, as we're reading this. But his message to her is, Ruth, I'm happy to do what you asked. In fact, I want to do what you've asked me to do. The problem is, you have asked me to do something that I have to go and get permission from someone who has more priority to you and for you than I do today. So we find out today what happens in that story. Are you ready for that? A Bride Worth Winning is our title. Verse 13 to 14. Stay this night, and in the morning it shall be that if he will perform the duty of a close relative to you, good, let him do it. But if he does not want to perform the duty for you, then I will perform the duty for you as the Lord lives. In other words, I promise you I'm going to do that. So lie down until morning. So she lay at his feet until morning, and she arose before one could recognize another. Then he said, do not let it be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. Do not let it be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. So she was at his feet until daybreak. Every husband's desire, right here in the Word of God. Yes. Good news. Good things to do, by the way, for us. We should be, and we're back and forth between the seen story and the unseen story, and we know that Boaz is a type of Christ, and I sense here this is a good thing for us to do too, that we be at his feet until the break of day before we go on our way, just as she did. That's exactly our mission statement, if you will, too, as we sit and rise in the morning. What's the first thing that comes to our mind in the morning? Our to-do list, get our coffee, or is it, Lord, thank you for another day. This is the day you have made, right? Do we give that day to the Lord right from the beginning? Put our priorities, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So all those things on your list and all those things we need to be done can be added as he's put first and foremost on that list. So she was there all night. Nothing improper, nothing immoral, just patiently waiting for all of this to unfold. You know, I find it so amazing for a woman who really is very new into the understanding of this God of Abraham, this Yahweh. She's got more faith than a lot of believers I know that have been walking with Jesus for years and years and years. She doesn't have any experience to know, is God going to come through? She didn't sing the song, Great is Your Faithfulness to Me, O Lord. She doesn't know to sing that, and yet she's so seeing, you know, the Lord through Naomi and through the encounter herself, that she just has left that old life and is walking so just flint-like, just so strategic and narrow walking to that life that she won't be moved. Boy, that's a beautiful illustration of every single one of us and what we should be doing. But he says to her, leave before the break of dawn so that there are no eyebrows raised as to her being there all night. Some things don't ever change. People still think the same, just like Solomon said, nothing new under the sun. So he has her do that. Boaz understands something about gossip, that people naturally assume the worst. People naturally assume the worst. There's a woman at Boaz's feet. They must be up to something. You know? But he knows that tongues will wag, tweets will tweet, and there'll be Instagram posts before noon. So he avoids the temptation of others putting themselves in that place, and he has her leave early. But before she goes, he says something, verse 15. Also, he said, bring the shawl that is on you and hold it. And when she held it, he measured 6 ephahs of barley and laid it on her. Then she went into the city. Well, what is all this about? Bring me your shawl. And as she does 6 ephahs of barley into it, this is a big bunch, again, supersized. This is the drive-through McDonald's, McDavid's supersized situation. This works out to be 6 ephahs, works out to be 30 gallons. 30 gallons he pours of barley onto this apron of hers, if you will, and off she goes. She goes off weighed down with a blessing and weighed down with a message that she doesn't even know she's carrying to Naomi. Let's see what that is, verse 16 and 17. When she came to her mother-in-law, she said, is this you, my daughter? So it's still early enough that she's not even recognizing her from the time of day it is. And then she told her all that the man had done for her. And she said, these 6 ephahs of barley he gave me. For he said to me, do not go empty-handed to your mother-in-law. Give these 30 gallons of barley to Naomi. Now, Naomi is Jewish, and Boaz is Jewish. Ruth is not Jewish, and again, she's not understanding all that there is that's involved in the background of the Jewish life, amen? But Boaz, and we need to read this with Jewish eyes, because Boaz is really sending a message to Naomi. And for us to get it, we need to hear it Jewishly. We'll put it that way. Let's see, verse 18. We'll continue. And she said, sit still, my daughter. And this is right after she sees these 6 ephahs of barley, 30 gallons of it. When she sees that, she says to Ruth, sit still, my daughter, until you know how the matter will turn out. For the man will not rest. For the man will not rest until he has concluded the matter this very day. Why would she say that? What was it about Ruth returning and this barley? What was it that would cause her to draw this conclusion? Well, I will tell you that Naomi gets it, because Boaz is sending a very Jewish message to her. Because it's really Naomi that needs to be redeemed. It's really Naomi that needs to be redeemed. So it says here he's not going to rest, she says, until he gets the matter resolved. Well, what matter are we talking about, you might ask? To redeem Ruthie, right? That's the matter at stake here. And like our Goel, Jesus, the matter of redemption is for him and him only to fulfill. She can't do a thing about it. She's done all she can do about it by coming to the Redeemer. But she can't save herself. Just like this Boaz is the only one who can save Ruth, our Boaz is the only one who can save us. And we can just rest in knowing that he's done the work. Amen? And so that's why she says, just sit still, just rest until the matter is done. Let him take care of the matter, in other words. Ruth has done her part by asking him. Now he's going to do it, at least we hope. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture of redemption. In John 17, Jesus prayed to the Father. Before the cross, he prayed this, right as redemption was about to take place. He said, I have finished the work that you have given me to do. Just about the same wording here. Then he went to the cross, and on the cross, he said, it is finished. Right? It is finished. And that word is one word in the Greek, and it's tetelestai, which is the word, it is finished. Again, in Greek, it's one word. Remember, always remember, church, it's his work. I have no idea how we have come to decades and centuries of church teaching that if you do this and you don't do that, and if you do 7 of some, hail somebody's and 7 water drinking things and wash your hands 15, how we have gotten to the place when we have this Bible in so many translations and so many understandable ways, and people who go to seminary, and learn these things, and we still are having a works-oriented religion. I think we're seeing in the undercover here of Ruth. See, Boaz is the one who's got to do the work. She cannot do a thing about it, and he is going to do the work. And that's why he said in John 17, he said, I have finished the work that you have given me to do. He hasn't given us that work. He's only given Jesus Christ that work. Always remember, Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. It's grace, it's all him, but it's faith in that grace. You've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift from God, and the rest of the verse says, lest any man should boast. Lest any, see, we're all level at the cross. Amen. You know, I love to give the example, if you lived in San Diego, and you have been practicing for years and years to be just wonderful swimmer, and finally the day comes that you and 10 of your friends are going to swim to Hawaii. Listen, nobody's making it to Hawaii in a human effort from San Diego. Now, some might get a little further. Some works and some training might give them ability to stretch a little further, but nobody can make it to Hawaii. So what difference does it make if you got a little further but you still drowned? Okay? The only one who can take us from San Diego to Hawaii is the one who created the Pacific Ocean.
Amen.
Right? So that's what's going on here. It's not our works. And yet, don't you find that, like, we tend to go back that, even as born-again Christians, we kind of look at somebody and go, well, you're a Christian, look what you're doing. And yes, we are supposed to inspect fruit. The word tells us you'll know them by their fruit. Well, that means you got to be a fruit inspector to see if the fruit lines up with the fruit of the Spirit. Right? But the point is that we don't judge that, but we do account that for relationship and roles in the church and things like that. But the point of the matter I'm making is it's not works to get to the Savior. Amen. It's only one work that provided for redemption, and it was him taking our place. And trust me, he knows how to swim to Hawaii. Amen. We just get on his back while he does the breaststroke, and we just follow him right on through. Amen. How does Naomi know this, though? Let's go back to that. How can she be sure that Boaz really wants to be the Redeemer? How can it be? Remember, I said that Boaz was sending a message that we need some Jewishness to be able to understand. How would she know that? How would she know? Well, the answer lies in the 6 ephahs that Boaz sent her. Take note. The number 6 isn't a casual number. It wasn't number 7. It's not number 8. It's not 4. It's 6. 6. Naomi, being Jewish and a person of the Torah, she would know right away that 6 days God worked. 6 days God worked, but on the 7th day, he rested. He rested. On the 6th day, God created Adam and Eve. And she's getting the message that Boaz is creating something, and he is not going to rest. He's going to work like those 6 days represent until, like our Boaz, Jesus, he redeems Ruth just like Jesus Christ redeemed us. Are you with me?
Yes.
And she would get that. And she was so happy about it, so she apparently received the message that was there. He was telling her something. So let's move on to chapter 4. And meet Danny DeVito in person. Now, Boaz went up to the gate, and he sat down there. So, again, she said he will not rest until he finishes the work. And right away, chapter 4, verse 1, now Boaz went up. So he is working, isn't he? And he sat down, and behold, the close relative of whom Boaz had spoken came by. So Boaz said, come aside, friend. Sit down here. So he came aside, and he sat down, and he took 10 men of the elders of the city, and he said, sit down here. And so they too sat down. In ancient biblical cities, the cities were walled, and they had gates. If you were with us not too long ago, we studied the whole book of Nehemiah. We learned a lot about walls and gates and all that surrounded and what the purpose was. They were certainly there to protect the city from intruders and from enemies. We learned that. But a city gate also had other functionalities to it. A city gate is a room with an alcove. It's not just a gate that swings open and shut. It's literally an alcove. There's an entrance into the courtyard of the alcove, and then there's another entrance actually into the city. So you have this vestibule, if you will, and it can be pretty large. And there are in there benches that are just crushed and strucken out of the stone and whatnot. Why? Well, kings, elders, and leaders of the city would sit at the gates of the city. The city gate was a place where judicial matters, legal transactions, and business would be solved and would be decided upon. It was a kind of a city hall, or your town hall, if you want, a very, very important place. If you've been to Israel with us, we've shown you what these look like. Some are still architecturally up that you can get a feel for these. And it's important to know when you're reading the Bible some of these, and it's why it's important to go to Israel, and we're going soon, in Jesus' name. And start planning now. Don't wait till we make the announcement. We are going to go unless Jesus comes and takes us first. So start saving, start planning now so you can see these things. And I'm telling you, your Bible will come alive, because when you read these kind of things, you can just video that in your mind and understand what is meant by these words. Everything is not explained in the word, but these words are there for us to come to a deeper understanding of them. So plan to go. The first place that a city gate is mentioned, believe it or not, is in the first book. It's mentioned in Genesis. In Genesis chapter 19, it said that it was at the gate of Sodom, so you know what we're talking about here, where Lot greeted the angelic visitors that came to the city. That was quite the day and quite what happened out of that. Amen. Abraham conducted business at a gate in Hebron. What was that about? Well, he spoke to the owners of Machpelah, if you remember that word, to barter a price for the burial spot for Sarah as she had passed. And he met and did that at Machpelah to barter, and it was at a gate that this took place. A business transaction was taking place there. Absalom, when he wanted to get the people on his side in the midst of a conflict that he was having with King David, would go to the city gates and say, if I were in charge, I would do this for you, and I would do that for you. He would fit in real good today, because he didn't do any of it. Anyway, yes. That's also why Jesus said, the gates of hell, see, we take you to Caesarea Philippi, right where Jesus said that, up in the northern part of the Galilee area, and we sit down and we have a little Bible lesson, and we just show you right there exactly where it took place. Jesus said the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Well, he wasn't talking about gates chasing the church all around, literal gates with hinges. No, he was talking about the strategies, the plans, the business ideas of hell won't prevail against the church. And I am so happy to be reminded of that today, because COVID is going to go, and so is all the authors of it, and anything that's causing this country that's under God and its believers, it won't prevail. Amen. It won't prevail. That's the promise of God and what he says we need to do. Amen? And so that's why Boaz is at the city gate. Because he wants to make a legal transaction. And this is where legal transactions takes place. And there he finds this close kinsman, this close relative, and 10 elders he has join him. Why 10? Why did he invite 10? Because 10 is the number of testimony. And there's going to be a testimony out of this. 10 is also the number of the law. And he's standing before these 10, the law, about a law matter he's going to bring forth. Fascinating, isn't it? Absolutely, positively amazing. And so he says to Danny DeVito this, verse 3 and 4. Then he said to Danny DeVito, I'm sorry, close relative, Naomi, who has come back from the country of Moab, sold the piece of land which belonged to her brother, our brother Elimelech, and I thought to inform you, how kind, saying, buy it back in the presence of the inhabitants of and the elders of my people. If you'll redeem it, redeem it. But if you will not redeem it, then tell me that I may know, for there is no one but you to redeem it, and I am next after you. So if you want to redeem it, redeem it, but let me know, because I am next following you. Naomi is back. Her property is up for sale, and you have the right to claim it. You have the right to possess it. It's yours, and it's up to you to decide to take it. Well, he says, great, sure. I'll take it. This is a great plan. This will increase my equity. This will increase my stock market, my holdings. This is going to be good for my portfolio. And besides that, she's really old. She's probably going to kick the bucket any time now. And she has no offspring. So I just get to keep it. I don't even have to share with her relations that come after, because there is none. The son's died. This is a great deal. I mean, who wouldn't turn this? Any businessman is not going to turn this down at all, right? So sure, I'll do it. And then I just thinking to myself, I wonder if Boaz was thinking, oy vey, you know, it looks like Danny DeVito instead of Tom Cruise is going to be the winner of the end of the show and of the redemption matter that's going to take place. But wait, this is like so theatrical, isn't it? Boaz has something in his anointed wise back pocket. And I want you to see it, verse 5. Then Boaz said, on the day you buy, excuse me, Danny. I just forgot to tell you one other thing. On the day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you must also buy it from Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to perpetuate the name of the dead through his inheritance. Are you following that? There's just one little thing. When you take possession of the property, it comes with the ladies. It's a package deal. It comes with the ladies. Ruth the Moabite and Mr. DeVito, she has to be your bride. Because in order for the Levirate marriage law to come to pass, he not only has to buy the land back, purchase it from her, but he has to make her his bride and have an offspring so that Malin's life his name can continue on. That's the whole purpose of the Levirate law, to carry on the name of the dead husband, right? That's what we talked about last week, all about that law and how it worked. So here's the deal. The property is yours, Danny, but it's a bundle package. We're going to bundle the whole package for you, right? You get Ruth the Moabite too. Now, remember, in our beginning time together, we discussed that the Moabites were a cursed race in relation to the Jews. Why? Because of we talked about what they did on their way into the Promised Land, and the word tells us that up to 10 generations, a Moabite could not enter the assembly of a Hebrew assembly. They weren't allowed to enter it. Knowing that, and the concern for his own probably wife and children and the inheritance that he has for them, he says this in verse 6. Never mind. No, I'm just kidding. And the close relative said, I just remembered. Something just came up. Yeah, I think my mother's calling me. I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I ruin my own inheritance. You redeem my right of redemption for yourself, for I cannot do it. Forget it. Forget about it. My wife is going to have a fit if she finds this out. And if mom ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. Amen. Right? So Boaz smiles and says, oh, darn, okay. It's okay. Yes, you know, that's exactly what took place. So if Boaz here is a type of Christ, which you know he is, and Ruth is a type of the church, she's a Gentile, that's exactly what we're looking at here, then who would the nearer kinsman be in our type and shadow behind the scenes illustration? If Boaz is the Redeemer, he's a type of Christ, and Ruth is a Gentile. She's a type of church. Who would the near kinsman be?
Holy Spirit.
Who say that? No. Mm-mm. I got to find my place. Yes. I'm glad you asked. Well, I'm looking. It's the law. It's the law. The near kinsman is the law. 10 men were there representing the law, right? But catch this, and don't miss this because it's so, so important. The near kinsman was unable to do the work just like the law is unable to finish the work in us. Praise God. Praise God. That's what the near kinsman represents, because that law was unable to finish the work. Unable to. Why? Because works don't work.
Amen.
Works don't work. Able to take the property, catch this, but not the people. The law was able to take the property, but not take the people where they needed to go. The law was good. No one says the law wasn't good. No one will ever say, in fact, the law was perfect. Jesus himself said the law was perfect, but it just wasn't able to help the people. It was to show the people that the law couldn't take the people. Are you with me? Why? Because we have attitudes. We have wrong thinking. It's not just what we do. It's how we process what we see. It's what we think. It's so much deeper. And I don't know about you, the longer you walk with the Lord, the more you see sin in our own life. It's not just, if I could just get delivered from cigarettes, whew, I'll be made perfect. No, because the next thing you find out there's another thing and there's another thing. And every single day you see the grace of God in our lives, because we have no conception of how often, just in our thinking, we sin every single day. See, and Jesus even said when he was going through the Beatitudes and whatnot, he said that, if you're even angry at someone, you've murdered them in your heart. The law couldn't be kept whatsoever. That's why this nearer kinsman represents the law, because it couldn't do anything for the people. It couldn't redeem the people. Reminds me of a story I once heard about a wife who was trying to get her husband up on a Sunday morning to go to church. And he just wouldn't, get out of the bed. And she's like, "Honey, come on, you got to get up. It's Sunday, They're expecting us to be there." "Oh, I don't want to go. I don't like it. I don't like those people." And she went in 10, 15 minutes later. "Honey, come on, you got to get up. We told them we would serve today. Remember, you're serving today." "I told you, I don't like those people." Finally, after the third time she went, she said, "Honey, you got to get up. You're the pastor."
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. I mean, ministry's great if it wasn't for the people. That's what this man is thinking, right? And that was the law. I couldn't do anything to minister to the people, right? So Boaz is the man. He steps in to take this place because Boaz represents Christ. Are you with me? Can we go a little deeper? Verses 7 and 8. Now, this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging. To confirm anything, one man took off his sandal and gave it to the other. Now, I was going to have you all take a shoe off, but I decided that might not be such a good idea. So he would take his sandal off and give it to the other. And this was a confirmation in Israel that the transaction was complete, right? Therefore, the close relative said to Boaz, "Buy it for yourself." And he took off his very sandal when he said that. Again, they would take off their shoe and give it to the one who would do it. Okay? What was he saying? Let me help you to remember this down the road. He was saying, "I can't fulfill this obligation. I know I'm a heel. I know I lack soul, right? I know I'm giving her the boot, right? I'm sorry. But in talking about this, Deuteronomy gives us a deeper understanding. If you remember, last week we looked at Deuteronomy about the Levirate law and what it functioned as. I deliberately didn't read you the rest, having to do with the Levirate marriage law, because I wanted to save it to this. So let's look at this in relationship to the verse we just looked at. Deuteronomy 25, 7 through 10 says, but if a man does not want to take his brother's wife, the verses before we're talking about what's supposed to happen, then let his brother's wife go up to the gate of the elders. Remember, this is a judicial place, place of business, transactions, all kinds of legal matters take place there, and say, my husband's brother refuses to raise up a name for his brother in Israel. He will not perform the duty of my husband's brother. Then the elders of the city shall call him and speak to him. But if he stands firm and says, I do not want to take her, then his brother's wife shall come to him in the presence of the elders, remove his sandal from his foot, and spit in his face. I know. It's something, isn't it, that old covenant? Whew. And answer and say, so shall it be done to the man who will not build up his brother's house. And his name will be called in Israel, the house of him who had his sandal removed. Can you imagine this? The house of him who had his sandal removed. I don't think Ruth spit in his face. I'm pretty sure, knowing Ruth's character, that did not take place. But the woman had the right to do that, because it was such a derogatory thing not to stand up for your family's name. And remember, we talked about part of why this Levirate marriage law was in place was to preserve the allotment of the land that was distributed in the book of Joshua. Each tribe was given certain areas, geographic areas, and placement. But within that placement, there was little cities and little towns and little neighborhoods. And so these people had possession of that. So it was more than just a nice thing to do for your family. It was had a bigger picture of preserving the bloodline in locality and whatnot. So, and I was thinking, you know, the shoe. Why the shoe? I mean, why didn't he take his hat off? Well, I was thinking wrong. I mean, like, why the shoe? Well, I thought about Joshua and the fact that a shoe always and our feet represent possession. Represent possession. Remember what God said to Joshua 1:3. I'm sure you do remember. He said, every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I will give it to you. Right? Later on in chapter 3 of Joshua, it says, put the soles of your feet in the Jordan River and the Jordan will part. Because shoes and feet and soles of feet always symbolize possession of something, okay? So in taking off the shoe, he is saying, I don't want possession of this situation. Okay? Interesting. So because he did that, like Orpah, this unnamed man just walks off into obscurity. He's never heard from again. He's never used again by the Lord. Jesus had his shoe taken off. Think about that. Jesus didn't refuse to redeem us or want to redeem us. No, he had his shoe taken off. He was stripped down. They took his shoe off and they spit on him. Not that he didn't want to take possession, but that they didn't want to give him possession. They said, we will not have this man rule over us. It's exactly what they said. And he was the rejected Goel. For some, he is our Goel, our Redeemer, and our accepted Goel and Redeemer, but he was also the rejected Goel. And anybody out there know he's still the rejected Goel in some people's hearts and minds as you minister to them. Amen? Verses 9 and 10, and we'll end here. And Boaz said to the elders and all the people, you are witnesses that day that I have brought all of this that was from Elimelech and all that was Chilion and Malion's from the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the widow of Malion, I have acquired as my wife to perpetuate the name of the dead through his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brethren and from his position at the gate. You are witnesses of that, of this day. We're going to close here, and the next time we get together, we're going to have a wedding that you're invited to. Next week, we're going to talk about Hanukkah, and I want to take a little moment and say, if you have never, you might think, why is she having something about Hanukkah? Well, because we're supposed to look. We don't trust the old covenant for our salvation, but it was perfect in its ways, and there's always richness, and there's always discipleship to be learned from looking at some of the things from the old covenant. And Hanukkah, actually Jesus was in the temple during Hanukkah. He actually went to the temple for this particular time, and Rob is going to share, I'm sure, some background to what Hanukkah is and why it's even celebrated, but also some practical things that we can utilize in our own life, as it's a festival of lights, and we are the light of the world, aren't we? We are the little lights, and Jesus is the big light. And then 2 weeks from now, we'll come back, and we're going to have this wedding. So, you know, put on your best attire, and, you know, it's going to be a special, special time. Here is Boaz. He's from Bethlehem. He's willing to buy a field to get a Gentile bride for himself. Now, Boaz don't need the field. He's got plenty of land. She was gleaning in the land. He's got plenty. He doesn't need the field, but in order to get her, right, he buys the whole field. Do you know Jesus, in one of his parables, said, and I love this, that the kingdom of God is like a treasure hidden in a field. The kingdom of God is like a treasure hidden in a field. The man sells everything he has to buy the field to get the treasure. That's us. Jesus bought the whole world, even the ones that were going to reject him. I've had people ask me, well, why in the world did he die for people that did what that he knew in his omnipotence weren't going to receive him? Yeah, he did know that. But he bought the whole world for the treasure of you that was within the field that he bought. Is that so awesome? Doesn't that just touch your heart amazingly? My, my, my. Do you see? Do you see? And we're going to continue to see as we approach the closing of this book, the beautiful picture of Jesus and his church in our time today. I hope you did. I sure hope you did. Have you responded to the invitation? Because there's a wedding every single day. There's a wedding feast going to happen at some point. But he's inviting people to the marriage every day. And in fact, he includes you as one of the catalysts for the wedding invitation. Have you accepted that invitation to unite with Goel, our eternal Goel, Jesus? See, for Boaz, there was a price that had to be paid to redeem. He had to buy everything off of Naomi, right? There are three things that have to be done for redemption to take place. Let's see if Jesus met them. We know Boaz did. First, he had to be of the family of us. A kinsman redeemer had to be of the same family. Jesus, born of a virgin in a Jewish family, he was of them, just like Boaz was. Second, he had to be able to buy it. He had to have the ability to buy it. We know that Jesus paid a ransom to buy us. What was that ransom? His life. His ability to buy us was through his life, not cash, but to buy us. We are more precious than any cash amount of anything. We're precious than pearls, right, the Bible says. And also, he had to be willing to do it. See, the nearer kinsman wasn't willing because the law could never save anyone. Jesus came to fulfill that law and made himself willing to purchase you. He ransomed us with his life, and he was born of the family who could be the kinsman redeemer of our life. Amen? I want to end with just this as our time closes. In that day, and probably somewhat today in ancient Mideastern areas, when you would go to the city hall, when you would go to the city gate and you would make a property transaction, it would always be rolled in a scroll. The guidelines to purchase this property, what was needed for this purchase to transact over to someone else's ownership. And there would be two copies. One would be given to the owner, and the other one would be kept, if you will, a city hall area where they would keep these kinds of things. So you had to be qualified, and they had seals on them. You had to be qualified to even break the seal, to even read inside what the scroll said. that would qualify the purchaser to meet the requirements to take on what was in the scroll. I want to read you something. And if you would stand, that would be great. Revelation 5. And I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back and sealed with seven seals. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and loosen its seals?" Is he qualified, in other words?
Amen.
Is this Boaz qualified? And no one in heaven, nor on the earth, or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to even look at it. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll or to even look upon it. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loosen its seven seals." And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne of the four living creatures, in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into the earth. Then he came and he took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb, with each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which were the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, singing, "You are worthy.
Amen.
You are worthy to take the scroll and to open the seals, for you were slain and you have redeemed us. You're the kinsman redeemer of us to God by your own blood out of every tribe and every tongue and every people nation. And you have made us priests and kings to our God, and we will reign on the earth." Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them were 10,000s upon 10,000s and thousands upon thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessings." I ask you, church, is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy?
Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? That you could see it all made new. Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone Spirit move among us.
Father, in Jesus' name, we are just smitten by what you have done for us, God. We just stand in such, in just worship to you, God. What you did to break those seals and open that scroll counted you worthy through all eternity. And we are eternally grateful. And we offer fresh and new to you, ourselves. We make ourselves this very moment a living sacrifice unto you, Lord Jesus. We know that you're coming soon, and everything is going to be made new. But for now, help us hear the assignment that you have given us each and every minute of every day, and not get caught up in the devil's schemes and plans and plots and strategies. You said the gates of hell would not prevail against the church, and we give it no right in our life, and we give it no ear to our life, God. Help us as we have a moment this week where we are extra thankful. Help it not to end on the 26th of November this year, Lord. Help us to continue and remain steadfast in an attitude of gratitude. We are so thankful. Yes. We are so grateful. We are just smitten with the love of God. May it compel us to go to the highways and byways and bring in those that are lost and populate heaven. That's our assignment. And the Church of God said,
amen.
Amen. Happy Thanksgiving. I hope it's a special one this year. Take this message out with you. Live your life like he's worthy. And let everybody know it. Amen. Love you. See you in a couple weeks.